Good evening, everyone. A warm welcome to all of you, and a big thank you to the Young Chartered Accountants Forum for inviting me to carry out this presentation today. And I think a special word of thanks has to be extended to Mr. J.M. Fazeer, who leads the Young Chartered Accountants Forum Governing Council. And of course, Ms. Nishadi Veeragala and Ms. Suimali Suravira for arranging this session. So for those of you who are about to fall asleep, let's first talk about return on investment. What we need to understand in terms of why all of us need to know etiquette and why we need to practice etiquette. Being accountants, let's first focus on what we would gain out of it. Is my screen visible to everyone or not yet?
Yes, Praveen, it's visible and all good. You can start.
Okay. Do you see it in presentation view yet?
Not yet.
Okay. All right. Yeah, it's all right now?
Yes.
Okay, great.
Yes.
Super. Right. So coming back to why you need to stay tuned is, so in basic terms, there are people who have superb business acumen, who are very adept with numbers, who have no difficulty in getting a balance sheet to balance. But if you struggle with people, if you struggle in situations, if you struggle in work atmospheres in terms of how you show respect or gain respect, then you will find it difficult to make the most of what you have in terms of technical knowledge and skills. So etiquette is something that's going to help you to overcome those struggles and be more confident about yourself. It sort of brings all of us onto a common playing field by all of us following these same guidelines. So if I were to say, your technical skills are like knowing how to bake a good chocolate cake, but if you don't know how to put good icing on it, it's very difficult to sell it. So the whole idea of embracing etiquette or empowering yourself by knowing good etiquette is like putting the icing on the cake, because you may make an excellent chocolate cake, but you'll find it very difficult to sell it. You'll find it very difficult to grow if little things like how you treat people, how you act and behave in certain situations, how you carry yourself don't add that value, don't give you that extra boost of confidence to handle a situation and go forward in the corporate world. So, from an accountant's point of view, your return on investment is you will be able to gain a better return on the investment you have made in terms of your technical skills by including little things like etiquette into your corporate life. So we talk about concepts, prudence concept, matching concept, and because we like theory, we like standards, we like to follow something. So why we do this is, or why we follow etiquette, or the whole idea behind etiquette is to make sure that we are all mindful of others, that we give, that we respect each other's personal space, each other's time. And so that as a group, as a community, we are able to share resources that are publicly available better, so that we come together and we are guided by the same sort of principles. Like, for example, you would have no difficulty in reading and understanding a profit and loss and a balance sheet that is prepared by a different company. So whatever I prepare as a profit and loss and balance sheet, you will easily read and understand. Similarly, whatever profit and loss and balance sheet that you prepare, someone else would be able to read and understand. That is because we are all guided by common guidelines, common principles, common practices, because we accept and follow a certain set of rules a certain set of standards, accounting standards maybe in this sense, and that is applied across the board. So there's a lot of similarity. So similarly, if all of us follow the same set of etiquette, if we embrace etiquette in our day-to-day lives, this same comfort or this same understanding is achieved across the community. So the whole idea behind learning etiquette is so that we are all guided by a common set of principles, right? So I'm supposed to talk not about your usual set of etiquette today. I'm supposed to talk to you about virtual etiquette in a corporate world. So I'm starting off with meeting etiquette. So one common question that is asked is, should your camera be on or off? Like I said, I'm not going to touch too much on the typical meeting etiquette about walking into a meeting room, how you sit down. I'm not going to talk about all of that because I'm supposed to talk mostly on virtual etiquette. But if you have questions on any of this in terms of general meetings or in terms of anything else that I'm talking of today, please feel free to raise those during the Q&A session. But I will try to focus as much as possible from a digital point of view, from a virtual point of view, right? So the question that a lot of people ask is, do I really need to keep my camera on, or how do I know when I should keep my camera on? So say, for example, I chose to switch off my camera today. I think it will be a lot more difficult for you to relate to this session, and you would not really be able to follow what is going on because you wouldn't see my gestures, you wouldn't see my facial expressions, and it would be a lot less interesting. So it automatically made sense that I would need to keep my camera on. But there are instances where it may not seem so obvious. So how do you decide on this? Let me tell you the etiquette of it. So the etiquette of it is, technically, the host should inform the attendees if the attendee is expected to keep the camera on. So by host, who I mean is not the person who arranges the Zoom meeting, but the person who sort of pioneers the need for the meeting, the person who's in charge of running that meeting. So technically, the responsibility falls on the organizer to inform the participants that it is necessary to keep the camera on. So this can be done in various ways. Like, for example, maybe when you're talking with the attendees, you can say something like, I'm planning to keep my camera on, and because I think that will make it more interesting and it will be easier for us to interact. Or in the invitation, you could put a note saying, please do keep your video cameras on. But let's say the organizer doesn't really follow this part of etiquette, because we are all still adjusting to virtual etiquette, right? So let's give them the benefit of the doubt in the event that you're not notified of it. And you are a participant. What you need to do is always be prepared to have your camera on. Don't rush to look for a comb or a shirt when someone switches on the camera. Instead, at all times, be ready when you're connecting to a meeting to switch on the camera when necessary. Because maybe sometimes you don't need to have your camera on for the entire duration. But at least when you're speaking, when the limelight is on you, you may need to use the camera, you switch on your camera. So what you could do as a participant is also ask the organizer, do you think that I need to keep the camera on, or do you think my team should keep the camera on? This makes it less confusing for everyone. So it's good to have this clarified. But if I were to say, okay, let's say you can't really ask the organizer whether you need to keep the camera on, then I would say always be prepared to keep your camera on and follow the guide or follow the lead given by the organizer. Once the organizer comes on, if he or she switches on his or her camera, then it's good to reciprocate. switch on your own camera, say hi, and say, and if you don't want to keep your camera on throughout, you could probably say, I'll switch on my camera again when I'm speaking. I'll keep it knocked off for the time being. Because I suppose there are times where you don't want people to be concentrating on what the other person looks like or what the other person's background looks like, but instead you want people to focus on the slides or what is being said by the organizers. So in that case, you can choose to knock it off at times. But the long and short of it is, it's good to be ready to have your camera on. And see, the whole purpose of meetings is for people to connect. And those days we could do this at a physical venue, in a meetings room. But since we can't do that anymore, don't lose out on the personal touch. Don't lose out on connecting. Instead, use whatever virtual tools that are available to keep bridging that gap. So always plan to have it on. But of course, if it's a regular meeting that you do with your team every day, then you probably don't need to switch it on every day. You can maybe once a week or something, maybe you can have a day where all of you decide, okay, we'll make it a little casual. Let's have a little bit of a chat instead of just talking about everything at work. So we'll spend 15 minutes to see what we still look like. That's something you can do when it comes to your regular team meeting. But otherwise, if you're connecting with a customer, if you're connecting with a supplier or a bank, or you're connecting with someone overseas, it's always good to continue to have that connection, right? So long and short of it, yeah. My answer to you would be plan to have it on. Choose to figure out when it should come on, but otherwise, plan to have it on. Second question that I hear often is a virtual background a must? The simplest answer is no. It's not a must. But there are a few things that, so I'm speaking about this from an etiquette point of view, right? So the purpose of a virtual background is to reduce the clutter, reduce the distraction. So we have our own lives to lead in our homes, right? So there could be kids running around the house. There could be people who walk in and around you. You may not necessarily have a table and a chair in a corner of the house where no one comes to. So all of that is understood. So maybe the way your table is positioned, your bedroom is behind you. So it would be for various reasons that you need to use a virtual background, or you could use it to promote your brand, whatever reason it is. Using it or not using it is entirely at your discretion. But what you need to know, what you need to be conscious of is you have a responsibility when you connect to a virtual meeting to not distract others. What you do when you come online shouldn't be distracting the people who are connected to the meeting. If there's a lot going on behind you, that's going to distract people from what's happening at the meeting. And the focus should be on you or the speaker or what's needed to be discussed at the meeting. It shouldn't be about whether your kid is jumping up and down on the bed or whether your dad is walking around the house. So that shouldn't be the focus, right? So reduce the clutter, reduce the distractions, use a virtual background for that purpose. And how should you deal with distractions? Meaning, what I mean here mostly is the telephone. Because the moment you are seated at home and working, everyone thinks you're not working. That's the usual thing when it comes to working from home. People think, okay, working from home, probably sleeping. But that's not the case. People who work from home all the time know that working from home is far more tedious than actually going to work and working. But so what happens is you keep picking the phone up. The moment you receive a call, you think, okay, I'm not the one talking. So you pick the phone up and you happily take a call. But that shouldn't happen. If you are expecting an important call during the same period as your meeting, you should notify the organizer that you're expecting a call and that you would need to be away from the call for about 10 minutes or 15 minutes until you finish that call, which is urgent. And maybe it's coming from overseas, maybe it's something, maybe you're waiting for a response which needs to be given to another party within a particular span of time. So I mean, we have multiple reasons for taking calls. So in such instances, the correct etiquette is to notify the organizer, look, I'm not going to be available for 10 minutes during this meeting. Don't just fall off the face of the earth because no one knows what's happening at your end. And that's another reason it's good to keep the camera on, right? Because you automatically, you're more disciplined about how, what you do and how you do things. But at the same time, if you do receive a call, do knock off your camera and take the call. And let's say it's something that you weren't anticipating, but it is urgent, pick it up, try and keep it as brief as possible. What I mean by brief is max 30 seconds, right? 30 seconds is a long time for a call. So pick the phone up, say, look, I'm at a meeting, unless it's really urgent, I think I may need to get back to you. And if it is super urgent, say, inform someone who's in your team who's connected to the call, send a message and say, look, I need to be out of this meeting for a while. Please take notes. In case someone looks for me, please tell them that this is what's happening. If possible, send a message to the organizer and say who. The organizer could be your superior, it could be an outside party, it could be that a customer is connected. So always remember that when a meeting is scheduled, that time is blocked for that purpose. So good etiquette demands that you keep your focus on what's happening during that meeting, during that time period. If you keep finding excuses to do other things, it shows lack of respect. It shows lack of respect to the others who are at the meeting. And it also shows that you're not really in control of your schedule. There are different types of meetings that we may need to host during a day or be a part of during a day. And there are certain meetings which maybe you take with a couple of people, which are more casual, which doesn't really require very specific time, meaning you could, maybe it's a part of your team. So you say, okay, let's get onto a call for 15 minutes, say after 4 o'clock today. Then if it's a meeting of that nature, then the demands from an etiquette point of view are a little less stringent. But if this is a properly planned out meeting where there are multiple stakeholders involved, then the correct thing to do is to give it that respect it deserves, because you're talking about the time of not one person, you're talking about the time of a lot of people, and all of these people have marked time out of their schedule to be at the meeting for a reason, and there is something that you want to achieve out of the meeting. So all of this is lost when you keep getting distracted, right? Some people, what they do is they connect to a meeting and switch over to a different tab on the laptop and start writing emails or start doing an Excel sheet of their own. Basically, they're not focused on the meeting. Again, not a good idea, because no one should have to repeat what is being told at a meeting to you later on. Or avoid the necessity to come online every now and then and say, oh, sorry, what was it that you asked? I wasn't really paying attention. Don't do that. That is, again, clear lack of respect for what is happening. I mean, there are times we miss out on words. There are times that the line breaks and it's not clear. That is understood. But repeatedly, if you are doing other things and then suddenly someone says, Praveeni, what do you think? I'll be completely disoriented if I am working on something else. So it'll take me a moment to figure out what was being talked about. And then to come back and try to answer becomes a huge challenge. So at that point, if I say, oh, I'm sorry, I wasn't really paying attention to that little bit, can you tell me that bit only again? That doesn't work out well. What you need to do is stay focused and contribute where necessary. That brings me on to the next question of when should you or when should you not talk? So when it comes to a virtual meeting, it's not easy to show that you have something to say. If you're at a physical meeting where 10 of you are seated around a table, through body language, through eye contact, maybe through a little bit of a raising of your hand, you can indicate to this person who's speaking that you have something to say, that you have something to add. Or maybe you can even interject a little bit and say, excuse me, I also want to talk about this. But it becomes a little more difficult when it's a virtual meeting. So what you need to do then is use the option of raising your hand virtually. That's the correct thing to do. If you've not fallen asleep by now, maybe you, all of you can raise your hand if that option is available, but I'm not sure whether the host has allowed you to raise hands. Nishadi, is it allowed? Oh, okay. Nishadi is raising her hand.
It is allowed, yes. The participants can interact.
Okay. So those of you who have not fallen asleep, maybe you can raise your hand and say that you are up and you did hear me say what I did.
I think we can see the number going up, isn't it, Praveen? So many hands going up, yes.
good. Okay. So you know how to use that option, and that's one thing you need to do. And if not, what you need to do is, I mean, if, say, for example, your raised virtual hand is not seen, what you can do is probably wait for a moment till the person who's speaking stops or seems to be coming to the end of a particular area, and then quickly knock on your microphone and say, excuse me, Praveeni, I would like to add this, or I would like to talk about this. So let me know, may I talk about it now, or shall I wait till you finish? Or maybe you could say, I also want to talk about this topic. So maybe towards the end of your discussion, maybe towards the end of your presentation, I would like to talk about it. Then that person knows, oh, okay, this is something that we need to talk about. And then he or she who's leading the conversation at that time will say, okay, why don't you talk about it now? Or say, okay, give me 5 minutes. I'm just finishing off this final topic. And once I'm done, that's a good topic. Let's talk about it. So that's entirely up to you to decide depending on the situation. But technically, keep your mic switched off at all times, unless you need to speak. And switch it on so that you don't intrude on someone else's platform. Don't get people to stop mid-sentence. That doesn't work out well. So try and be subtle about how you're doing it, but don't try to be too pushy when you want to talk. But either use one of these tools like hand raising, or maybe sending a message on the chat box if you know that person's checking the chat box often, or else if none of that seems to be working, you can wait till the person tones off the conversation a little bit and chip in. And also, of course, you need to be spot on and ready when someone says your name. If someone says, Praveeni, what do you think? Or Praveeni, there was another problem that you were telling me about 2 weeks ago. Can you explain that here? Then don't flounder around. Then don't take 20 seconds to switch on your mic. You should be on the tab. You should be available. You should be able to switch on your mic and speak really fast. Because otherwise, no one knows what's happening. No one knows whether your video is frozen. No one knows whether you're still there. If you've knocked off your camera and you've gone for a walk, no one really knows. So don't let that happen. Right? And try to avoid having you know, little chit chats on the side. You know, your spouse comes by and you want to have a chat. Try to avoid doing that during a meeting, because that again causes a lot of distraction, right? So basically, pretend that you are actually inside a meeting room. Pretend that you're inside the boardroom that you're usually inside. Think that everyone around the table is looking at you, and sit and concentrate on what's going on. If you try to do that, I think that might help you follow better meeting etiquette automatically. So I'll move on to texting and email etiquette, but please do feel free to come back to me and ask any other meeting related questions that you have. What we need to do here is, like I said, treat it as a regular meeting and don't be obtrusive, be focused on what's going on. Show respect, because again, like I said, etiquette is about showing respect, being for all of us to be able to succeed, for us to achieve a common goal. We need to follow a set of guidelines. That's what we are doing through learning my meeting etiquette, right? So if there are other things that bother you, which may even be things that happen in face-to-face meetings, that's fine. Please feel free to raise them as questions and I'll be happy to answer. So in terms of texting and email etiquette, so previously we would have just peeped over, or we would have looked over our shoulder, or we would have walked 10 feet and clarified certain things, but we can't do any of that anymore. So the question is, okay, do I text, do I email? Is this a topic that I should be sending an email about, or should I be sending a text message about this? Or should I not text my boss? Is that weird? Those are the kinds of questions that you would have from an etiquette point of view, right? So in simple terms, how you choose between emailing and texting is, okay, let's see. Texting is more like placing a call, but you don't call, you text sort of thing, right? What you need to say or what you need to ask. Instead of saying it verbally, you type it out. I see a lot of pluses in texting over taking a call, because one thing is it saves time, right? You send the message and then and it's done. Then you wait for the response. Whereas if you take a call, you dial, you wait, then that person, you have to wait till that person answers. Then that person says, oh, 1 second, I'm just finishing another call, puts you on hold, or says, oh, wait one moment. Pankarya came, let me just go and get my loaf of bread and come. So it can be a little messy like that. So I understand that texting is a more powerful tool in this context. So try and use texting instead of emails, or use text messages or WhatsApp or Telegram. I don't think people use Messenger much for official purposes, but then I suppose WhatsApp is probably the most common right now, and normal text messaging. So when I say texting, I mean whichever platform, right? It doesn't necessarily have to be an SMS. It could be an SMS, it could be a WhatsApp message, it could be a Viber message, whatever it is, a WeChat, whatever. So in each of these instances, what you need to know is, how fast do you want the response? And is this a conversation? Is this like, should I do this or should I do that? And then says, okay, don't do this because of that reason. Instead, why don't you look at another option? If you try to do this via email, you keep exchanging about 10, 12 different emails on the topic, and it's a little more time consuming than sending a message. So I would say use text messages for conversations, quick conversations, not long conversations. Not things that need a lot of deliberation where you need to have an active discussion. No, leave that for a phone call. Don't do that over a text message. There are certain topics that are better discussed over a phone call. Right? For example, if you're unhappy about something that happened and you need to give some feedback to your team, don't use a text message. Call. Call and say, look, this has happened. It's not so great that happened. It shouldn't have happened that way. And I want you to be conscious of it. I want you to fix this. So don't use a text message for that. If it requires a discussion and that human touch is needed, definitely take a call over a text message. But use text messages for quick clarifications, for things that you need done really fast, right? And use an email when it's more official, when it's when it needs to be clearly documented, when there has to be a track record of it, when it's something that a lot of people need to know, then use text messaging. But I know a lot of you will probably say, hey, why not use a WhatsApp group? I agree with you. Again, don't use it for everything which is formal. You can use WhatsApp groups. They're very powerful, very strong, very active, very, you get responses much faster. All of that is true. So use WhatsApp group messaging when, again, it's something you need to communicate fast. It's something that is not a long conversation. It doesn't require a lot of deliberation. Use it for that purpose. Maybe it's to give a group of people an instruction. It's like, send this letter out to the bank and make sure that these transactions take place. Or it could be to say, we have got a notification from the government about this. Here, get your act ready as soon as possible. I'll send you an email on the instructions. When you want to get a message across fast, use it. But otherwise, don't try to use text messages for everything over email. Email is more formal, and I know it sounds strange because we also come from an era where we saw letters being written and posted and sent by registered post. But so emails have now sort of evolved to a level that they're as good as a letter. Maybe not quite, but as good, right? I would say they've achieved about 80% success rate as opposed to a letter, in terms of formality, that is. So decide on what you text and what not to text based on that. Don't try to have long conversations via text messages. That doesn't work out well. And what sort of display pictures should you use on your WhatsApp or your WeChat or your Telegram? Don't try to make it too personal if it is your office phone, especially. But if it's your personal phone, I do understand that we have lives beyond our offices. So having your personal touch, having your personal pictures is fine. But if it's an office phone, try to keep it official. Right? Use something either neutral or use something like something corporate. It could be a picture of you, but something that gives a bit of a corporate presence of yourself. And keep the mushy ones for your personal life. Don't try to put all of that here. It becomes a little, it can raise a few eyebrows, basically. That's all I'm trying to say. Right, and should you respond to a text message, to a call with a text message, right? This is another question that I'm asked often. So two things. If you're not able to answer a call and you're sending a message to say, look, I will attend to it, for God's sake, don't send a message saying, can you call back later? If you're not answering the phone, it's obvious that that person has to call you back later if he or she wants to get through to you, right? Instead, what you can say is, I'm at a meeting. Can you please call me back in half an hour? That makes more sense. Can you call back later? Later? What is later? 15 minutes? Tomorrow? Never? What? Not really sure of that. If you're sending a text message to say that you're busy, that's fine. In fact, that's a great thing to do. But make it clear. Say something like, I'm at a meeting now. I will call you back. Ideally, that's what you should do. When you receive a call and you're not able to answer, the correct thing to do is not to tell the other person to call you again, but for you to call back as a priority. For you to remember once you come out of the meeting, or once you finish your virtual meeting, or once you finish whatever you're doing, to call that person back, right? But in the event that you want to indicate to that person, look, I'm busy, you can say that. You can say, I'm at a meeting, or I'm in the middle of something, or I'm occupied right now. But I'll be free towards evening. That's fine. But give an indication. Don't say something like, can you call back later? it's obvious that the person has to do that when you cut the line or when you don't answer the phone, right? But if someone calls and you send a message saying, you had called, that doesn't sound right, because you need to respond through the same mode of communication. So ideally you should call back, but in the event you can't call for some reason, let's say you've lost your voice or there's a problem with your phone and you can't call, but you can send a message, then it's fine. But say so. Say, look, I'm sorry, I'm unable to call you. You don't really have to give a reason. But you can say, I'm sorry, I'm not able to call you now, but I can text you. But I can talk to you. I can discuss whatever you need via text message. So can you please text me? That's fine. That's all right. But say so. Don't just blatantly ignore the fact that the person called you and pretend that that never happened, right? Instead, if the person called, okay, say, sorry, I can't take your call now, or I don't think I'll be able to call you back. But if you send me a message, I might be able to check on it and respond. That seems very fair and very straightforward. That's fine. Then is there an acceptable response time for messaging? So messaging and emails both, right? Now, the situation is such that you're not able to walk up to a person and ask. So if I see that my colleague is in office, I can walk up to him and ask if I have something to ask. But if that's not the case anymore and you don't really know where that person is, that person could be at home, that person could be somewhere else, and you want a response. So you don't really know, you're just blindly sending out a message or an email and you're hoping that this person will see and respond fast, right? So that's what you have to bear in mind. The other person doesn't know anymore and the other person's reaching out to you for a reason. So it is your responsibility to get back to the person as soon as possible. So to answer this question about, is there an acceptable response time? Arguably, maybe 20 minutes, I would say max. Within 20 minutes, try to respond to a text message or a WhatsApp that comes to you. This is especially during office hours, right? If you're expected to be working, you're expected to be working. And you can have, you need to make sure that these different channels are open for people to reach out to you. Your phone via text message, your phone via a WhatsApp message, your phone via a call, your laptop via an email, whatever other modes of communication that are used. Maybe your office is used to doing Skype calls. So you do a call from the laptop. So whatever those channels are that are discussed and agreed on or that are granted to you from the company or your organization, those need to be available during the entirety of your working hours. So if you say, I didn't see the text message you sent me yesterday. Oh, I'm so sorry. That doesn't look good on you. That doesn't look like you're paying attention to what you should be. Because see, one channel is entirely closed. People can't come up to you and talk to you anymore. People don't know whether you're working or not. You could be sick and your colleagues don't necessarily know, right? Because your boss will know if you're sick and you're not working that day, but the others won't. So don't just fall off the face of the earth. If you're not in office specially, this really matters. Keeping these channels open and responding within an acceptable period of time. So text messages, I would say 20 minutes should be like a max. Try and manage your text messages during that period of time, right? And when it comes to emails, see, certain emails, you're not able to respond in 20 minutes. I'm not asking anyone to send an email response in 20 minutes. That's not possible sometimes, right? But the correct thing to do is then send an email. Okay, emails, you don't need to respond in 20 minutes. What I'm saying is emails, let's say maybe every 2 to 3 hours, sort of, you would need to send out a reply at least. But if you're not able to send a reply, you need to acknowledge the email. You can send a mail saying, your contents are noted. Please give me time to get back to you. or my team will call you back, or my team will get back to you on this. And let's say, for example, you're asked to submit a report, not able to submit a report in 2 hours. That doesn't happen, right? That's not practical. So yeah, let's say you need 2 days for it, that's fine. So you send out an email saying, the request is noted. Please give me time until Tuesday afternoon and I will get back to you. Then the other person knows, okay, so-and-so is working on it. That's important. Similarly, when it comes to a text message, the whole purpose of texting over an email is because you want a quick response, right? That's why we need to manage this in 15, 20, half an hour max. So if we say, if we have a set of messages that we haven't responded to, that's something we need to be on top of. That's a channel that we have to keep open. So let's say you can't give an answer. Let's say though the person needs a quick response, you need time to figure things out and give a response. Then say, look, I need time till afternoon to get back to you because I'm not sure. I have to clarify a few things before I give you an answer. I need to check the system and I need to run some reports before I tell you whether this is a yes or a no. That's fine, but acknowledge so that the other person knows, okay, this channel is being attended to. My request has been looked at. That is important because communication is two-way. Remember, right? So again, purpose of etiquette, the concept behind etiquette is to respect and for all of us to be able to achieve our goals together as a community. And for all of us to have a common set of guidelines to be, for a common set of practices for us to be guided by. So if someone sends a text message and you just don't respond very happily, the other person is left wondering what on earth is going on. Should I call? Should I not call? Is this person ill? Is this person not working? That person has a lot of unanswered questions. But if you respond saying, okay, give me time till tomorrow, or give me a few minutes, I'll get back to you. That person knows this communication, the purpose of communication shouldn't be lost in a virtual environment, right? So that's the importance of making sure you respond within a particular frame of time. Right, here I've put down something a little more boring. So this is more like a thing that you need to know from about emails, irrespective of whether you're in office or not. I put these down here because for the sake of completeness, I mean, if irrespective of whether we are in office or whether we are sending the email from home or whether we are sending the email from the beach, there are certain things that you need to follow when it comes to an email, right? So these are a few of those. One thing that's really important is to have a clear subject which is understood. Like, for example, don't just put your company name and send an email. I mean, I wouldn't send out an email saying CL Synergy. So CL Synergy, what? What are you talking about? Are you talking about the company profile? If so, say CL Synergy Private Limited corporate profile, or you know, CL Synergy profile or something like that. Don't just say CL Synergy. Don't just put your company name, or don't say something like, you know, accounts or financial information about what, about what, for what period. Have something sensible in your subject so that emails can be picked up based on the subject. If you have a very vague subject line, it makes it so much more difficult for someone to figure out what the email is about. And sending emails without a subject is really not an option. That's clearly a no-no. That's as if you don't know what you're talking about. So make sure that you have proper subjects and title your attachments. Don't send things like IMG 001 or copy of Excel 001. That makes no sense and is of no use to anyone. Instead, title them suitably. Say something like, you know, debtors list for the month of August, or say bank balances as at 1st September, something that makes sense, something that is informative. especially if you have multiple attachments, in which case you really need to title them clearly, so that people who are reading your email don't waste time opening attachments that are not relevant to them or are not of priority to them at that moment. Say, for example, you have a summary and a worksheet. They would want to know what's there in the summary, but the worksheet they'll look at later. So don't get them to open, download, open, wait, and then read multiple attachments. Instead, save time for everyone. Even for you, it's easier when you have a properly titled document saved in your PC, because you can easily find it later. So save time for everyone by having proper names for everything. Who do you put in the to, who do you put in the CC, and who do you put in the BCC, or who do you not put in the BCC? The to is for who is supposed to action your email, who is to whom it is directed, or to whom it is directly relevant. The CC is for whoever who needs to know what's going on. It's to be in the mail loop. BCC is a no-no. You don't use BCC for corporate official emails. You use BCC when you need to send a mail out to a lot of people saying the same thing and they don't know each other. Say, for example, you're shifting from your current office to a new location and you want to tell a whole set of suppliers. So you send out one email to all the suppliers, put all of them in the BCC and say change of operating location or something like that in the subject and send an email. That's fine. But otherwise, don't put people in the BCC. Then, of course, avoid using old emails for new topics. Don't send emails without a signature. Anonymous emails are not good at all. And set up automated out-of-office emails. This is a feature that's available in pretty much any email package. Please use it. If you don't know how to use it, get your IT team to help you. And if you're adding new people onto a mail loop, mention that so that people aren't caught off guard when they're responding, right? You can say simply something like adding the finance team onto this email or adding the managing director onto this email so that it's clear. And see, people may not know people by name, but if you say I've added the managing director onto this email to look into your concern, then they know, okay, so the new person who's in the mail loop is the managing director. That's clear. And don't wait for a call to check your email. If you do fall into that category, please elevate yourself out of that. Be the professional you should be. Don't wait for a call. Instead, please, please do check your mail and respond. Don't expect someone to give you a call. Don't say, you should have called me, I would have then responded. Right? Nishadi, do I need to offer the stage to you for a moment?
Oh, no, no. I was just listening to you for a very interesting presentation.
Okay, no, I thought when you put it on your phone.
Yeah, we might have to be a little mindful of the time. Just to,
sure.
Yeah. All right. We are getting so many questions. So I have a long list of questions.
Right. Okay, thank you. All right. Okay, so moving on to texting etiquette. Don't use texting, text messaging apps, or don't keep texting people like you text your friends. In office, you're there to work. So if you need to talk to someone via text message, I mean, we have talked about why we would use text messaging, right? So if we need to, if you need to send a message out, don't talk about the cats and the dogs and what that person had for lunch. No, leave out all that nonsense and focus on why you are sending a message. You don't send a hi and then just go missing, because then the other person won't know whether you just want to say hi or whether you had actually had something to say. Say hi and say, hi, I need to talk to you about this. Or hi, this is my concern, or this is my question. Then that person knows, okay, it's very focused. You're done. You get a response and that's it. That's the purpose of texting. I don't try to use texting for unofficial purposes with your colleagues, it becomes a nuisance for them, right? And when it comes to using stickers and GIFs, I mean, you can use this with your colleagues, I mean, your friends, right? That's not the issue. But the problem is when you try to use these with outsiders and maybe people who are very much senior to you, or maybe even sometimes with people who are very much junior to you, don't try to be too casual and too unofficial and send things that won't really reflect who you are in the organization. So be mindful of it. If you want to try out the new stickers, try it out with a friend, right? If you want to try out the new GIFs, yes, please find a friend and do it. Send the messages to a friend. Don't try all of that out with everyone who works with you, because it can become a little awkward. So don't go there. And don't abbreviate too much, because everyone may not be as comfortable as you are with text messaging lingo. So don't make them wonder what on earth you're talking about. Purpose of communication is lost if the message is not understood by the other party. So be mindful of that. And if the other person isn't responding, don't send 150 messages and then expect that person to respond to each one of those 150 in one go. That doesn't work that way. That person may have had an emergency at home and was not able to respond to you. So you're not aware of a lot of things. So don't just send a whole 150 messages. And in the process, don't get offended. Don't say things like, why aren't you responding to me? Why are you ignoring my messages? Oh, please, no, don't put drama to people like that over text messages. That doesn't work either, right? And if it's something lengthy that you need to discuss, remember, always better to take a call, right? Because otherwise, if you think it's going to be very iterative, instead of sending messages for 1.5 hours to each other, send a message saying, I have something to talk to you about. This is the topic. Can we get on to a quick call? I think we should be done in about 15 minutes. Use that option then, right? Be more conscious of how your time and other people's time are going to be utilized. So send a text message, say, let's have a call, and figure out a convenient time and get on to a call, right? So in the interest of time, I'm going to condense this, but I'm moving on to interview etiquette. So interview etiquette, I will be talking to you from the angle of both the interviewer, meaning the panel, and as well as the interviewee, meaning the candidate, right? Dress for the occasion. As an interviewee, we are all very much, this has been drilled into all of us quite a bit. It's like, you know, dress well, don't dress like this, don't do this, don't do your hair that way, don't put too much makeup, don't do this. We have a lot of don'ts and do's when it comes to being an interviewee. And all of that is good. All that you've heard must be right. Make sure that you dress formally, because this is a formal setup, right? You walk into a corporate, you want a job, you do need to be formal, right? Unless, of course, you know, you're signing up for a position at Disneyland or something, you are expected to be formal. So have it that way. So dress formally. As an interviewer, same applies to you. What you need to be mindful of is, see, a candidate who walks into your office sees the physical evidence. The person who walks into an office likes what he or she sees as well. But when it's a virtual interview, a lot of these elements are lost. You could be having a great office. You could be having a super culture. Maybe the atmosphere is just spot on. And all of these are reasons for people to want to work for a company. But that is not visible anymore when it comes to a virtual interview. But you, as the interviewer, as a part of the interviewing panel, will be the ambassador that carries that great feeling, that wow factor. You can't show a picture of your office and say, oh, this is what our office looks like. It's really great. You should join. You can't do that. But that wow factor has to come from you. So as an interviewer, as someone who's sitting down to interview someone, you also need to carry that corporate presence. You need to carry the culture, the what you try to show through your physical evidence in office needs to be carried by you. And one way of doing that is by dressing appropriately for the occasion. So don't wear the same t-shirt you were wearing at home the whole day when you're interviewing. Bother yourself to, you know, wash your face a little bit and put on a better shirt and or a better, some kind of better attire so that the person who you is being interviewed takes it seriously and feels, oh, wow, these people actually bother. These people may take an interest. And follow pretty much all the other guidelines in terms of connecting on time, being focused on the interview, asking questions that make the interviewee feel valued, being respectful. Do all of that and carry, the only way you can carry that physical evidence, the only way you can carry that corporate outlook of your organization is through your appearance. So do justice to your organization. So it depends. I mean, I can't tell you that it has to be a shirt, or I can't tell you that it has to be, I can't tell you that your hair has to be in a particular way. That's not the idea. It has to reflect what your organization represents, right? And as an interviewee, similarly, there is a perception that you have of the organization. So dress to suit that. And what is also important is for you to be confident. Like, for example, I mean, I don't sit at home on Saturday afternoons wearing a sari, but I chose to wear a sari today because I'm very confident and I'm very comfortable in one. And I would feel underdressed if I didn't wear a sari. So it's entirely up to you to do what you think is going to make you confident, what's going to keep you comfortable. So comfortable doesn't mean, you know, beach wear, right? That doesn't work for an interview. So play it safe. It's always better to play it safe when you're not sure. And prepare the household, right? Try and tell the neighbors, you know, I'm going to be facing an interview. So make sure your dog doesn't bark. And basically, you know, try and keep everyone informed so that they're not going to suddenly start come and barge in. And if you have kids, someone will try to mind the babies so that you're not disturbed by them. So try and prep the household. Both the interviewer and the interviewee need to do this, because if you keep getting disturbed, it doesn't reflect well on your organization if you're the interviewer. And as an interviewee, the interviewers aren't going to sit there and wait while you attend to your personal matters and then interview you. That doesn't work. So be mindful of that and keep everyone informed. Look, 2 o'clock to 2:30 tomorrow, don't talk to me. I have an interview. I need to get the job. So please keep the household in order and help me. Right? And don't keep getting distracted. Again, just like meetings, don't keep looking elsewhere. Say someone at home walks past you while you're at the interview. Don't do this, right? Instead, stay focused. Look at the camera, stay focused, and show that you're interested in what's going on. Interviewer, interviewee applies to both of you. Don't get distracted by things that are happening, right? This happens very often. You're seated there listening to the interviewee, and then you're kid walks by and you're like, oh, how cute. Don't do that. Hey, instead, stay focused on the camera, because the person, because this is eye contact. This is the only eye contact we can ever have, right? Through in a virtual platform. So look at the camera and stay focused. Look at the screen and keep your eyes here. This is the moment you start doing this and start looking at the roof. Both parties get confused. They're like, am I not answering the question, or have I said something wrong? It puts everyone in a bit of a flux. Don't do that. Okay. Be prepared to share your screen, because I mean, it depends on the kind of job you're applying for, but there may be instances where someone would say, oh, I would love to see some of your work. Can you share with me if you're, say, for example, applying for a creative job, they might want to see something that you've created. So at that moment, don't flounder around. Don't try to erase your wallpaper, which has a picture of your favorite actresses or something like that. So okay, keep it clean. Be ready. Make sure you can share your screen if necessary, right? And keep your desktop free of clutter. It helps, right? And then, of course, connect beforehand, check your sounds, check your connectivity, pay $500 more, get extra bandwidth if you think it's necessary. Get your lighting right? The light shouldn't be behind you, it should be in front of you so that there's enough light falling on your face. Don't let the interviewer tell you, oh, I can't see you. Can you please move this way? Can you please move that way? It wastes time, right? We're learning etiquette so that we don't waste each other's time, right? So don't let that happen. Switch on the lights, surround you, switch the camera on, get a friend to connect to it, to your Zoom session. See, ask the person, okay, look, do I look all right? Because this is what the interviewer is going to see. If that person says, no, I can't see your face, go find a light, bring it, keep it in front of your face, or move, take your laptop and go somewhere where you can be seen. Do all of that beforehand. Once the interview starts, it should be just as though you walked into a meeting room, sat down, and you're starting the interview, right? And you usually see the name of the person on the Zoom session during the interview. So you would see the interviewer's name. So we're Sri Lankan, so don't try to go with the first name. At all times, try to do the surname with the salutation, right? If the name is not seen, go with sir or madam. Don't try to be too casual. Don't try to be too friendly. They're trying to give you a job, so give them that respect, because you want, because by giving respect and showing respect, you just show that you are well brought up. It doesn't add value to the other person, right? So you don't need to feel bad about it. Right.